Mayor of the Fort Hill Nation in Spanish. Señor, abre nuestros corazones y mentes por el poder de la Santa Iglesia. Que cuando las escrituras sean leídas y tu palabra proclamada, podremos oír con gozo lo que tú nos dices hoy. Amén. For the gospel lesson today, it's going to be Matthew chapter 25, verses 14 through 30. You can please stand. And you can also look at the Matthew Bible, which is page 1256. For the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling to a far country, who called his own servants and delivered his goods to them. And to one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to teach according to his own ability, and immediately he went on a journey. Then he who had received the 5 talents went and traded them with them, and made another 5 talents. And likewise, who had received 2 gained 2 more also. But he who had received 1 went and dug in the ground and hid his Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants came and settled accounts with them. So he who had received 5 talents came and brought 5 other talents, saying, Lord, you delivered to me 5 talents. Look, I have gained 5 more talents besides them. His Lord said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. He also had received 2 talents. He who had received 2 talents came and said, Lord, you delivered to me 2 talents. Look, I have gained 2 more talents besides them. His Lord said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. Then he who had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you have not sown, and gathering where you have not scattered seed. And I was afraid and went and hid your talent in the ground. Look, there you have what is yours. But his Lord answered and said to him, You wicked and lazy servant, you knew that I reap where I have not sown, and gather where I have not scattered seed. So you ought to have deposited my money with the bankers, and at my coming I would have received back my own with interest. Therefore take the talent from him and give it to him. He has 10 talents. For to everyone who has more will to be given, and will have abundance, but from him who does not have even what he has will be taken away. And cast the unprofitable servant into the outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Thanks be to God. And you can go ahead and please sit down.
What we're going to hear about this morning is really pretty simple and straightforward. But I would encourage you to be reminded, like so many aspects of God's kingdom versus earthly kingdom, we can't necessarily understand it all with just a concept or an idea. So much of it we simply understand once we start to live it. Let us pray. We pray, O Lord, that you would write your words upon our hearts so that they may guide us for the journey. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Today's parable reminds us that frequently scripture is completely counterintuitive. As he often does, Jesus tells a parable as a teaching tool. And like many parables, the final twist challenges our assumptions. Recall the parable of the prodigal son, which features a father kindly welcoming home his wayward son, and who some reading the parable might assume that the punchline would be a punishment and not an embrace. Or consider the parable of the widow and the unjust judge, an account in which a judge, rather than dismiss the woman for disorderly conduct, declares leniency on the poor widow because she persists and wears him down. As a reader, we may initially assume that her uncouth approach would only lead to a dead end. Today's parable, in which Jesus employs dramatic hyperbole, a type of exaggeration in story common to first century rabbis, Jesus sets us up, ready to assume the punchline. The story is straightforward. Jesus describes a wealthy man entrusting his servants with great responsibility while he is gone by giving them large sums of his money. The master gives one servant 5 talents, another 2, and another 1. At the time, the talent is what we would say in Spanish, mucho dinero. One commentator says that talent was equivalent to 15 years of wages of a day laborer, and another says 20. For a servant, being given 1 or 2 or 5 talents to remain in his or her custody might be considered an honor and certainly a significant responsibility to be taken with the utmost seriousness. Nothing out of the ordinary so far. So the 2 servants receiving the most talents took them and worked them like ancient hedge fund managers. They risked them in business ventures, intent upon growing their master's investments and returning them with dividend earnings. The servant given only 1 talent played it safe. He dug a hole in the ground and hid the talent so that he would be sure not to lose the master's money. The text tells us that he feared the master, not so much like fear as reverence, but fear as he was scared, and decided that caution was the better part of valor, or in the words of Shakespeare's Henry IV, the better part of valor is discretion, in which better part I have saved my life. Hermanos y hermanas, what would you do if God entrusted you with something of great value? Ought we not applaud the man for his prudence, for being careful with his role? When we are entrusted with something of great value, doesn't common sense tell us to be careful? We put inheritance in a bank, jewelry in lockboxes. When it comes to our children, most parents work painstakingly to teach them and protect them until they can be on their own. Our instinct with precious things is to protect them. Now comes the counterintuitive twist. When the master returns from the journey, the 2 servants given the most talents, the same 2 who took more risk, doubled their returns, and they met their master proudly. Whereas the servant who hid the talent is told the following from his master: "You wicked and lazy servant, you knew, did you, that I reap where I do not sow and gather where I do not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money at least with the bankers, so I could have gotten my return with some interest." So the master takes the talent from the man and tells us that for all who live with abundance, they will find abundance. But those who live with scarcity, they will live and experience scarcity. The man is not praised for his carefulness, but rather chided. And here's where the rabbinic hyperbolic exaggeration comes into play. "You worthless servant, he's thrown out into the outer darkness with the weeping and gnashing of teeth." I think Jesus is trying to make a point. So much for a conservative investment strategy. The twist tells us that Jesus, in no uncertain terms, exhorts his followers to use the gifts that they are given. Not hoard them, not sit on them, not be overly protective with them. And that involves risk. 20th century theologian Reinhold Niebuhr address such risk, telling the tale of a young boy, a Flatlander farm kid, who had always dreamed of going to sea. He dreamed of being a deckhand on one of the tall sailing ships of the last century. After years of planning, he slipped away from the farm one night, made his way to the nearest port, and signed on a great sailing ship as a deckhand. It was just as he had dreamt it, until the third day at sea. The captain ordered him up the main mast to assume watch over the crow's nest near the top. The boy climbed halfway up the towering tower, and he froze, afraid to risk the rest of the climb. Afraid of the taunts of the sailors on the deck below if he climbed back down. Don't worry, God calls at all times. At that point, Niebuhr ended the story. He ended up with the kid neither all the way up or all the way down. Now, of course, we know the boy didn't stay there. He either went up to the crow's nest or he slithered back down to the deck. Today's parable of the talents, today's ritual of dedicating our offerings for the coming years, presents us with a counterintuitive challenge. Jesus asks us to consider our relationships with that which we hold dear. The parable uses talents to symbolically identify anything that we would greatly value and consider blessed to have in our possession. What is that for you? What in your life do you cherish as a blessing? The same question may be posed for our congregation. What does this congregation value and hold dear? Our beautiful sanctuary, our beautiful music, our welcoming community, our outreach to the community, our vibrant worship, our rich history that goes way back. Once you have a clear picture in your mind what it is that you value in this congregation, the next step is to consider whatever it is, a talent, and to recognize that God has entrusted you with that to use it. Are we taking those talents and burying them in the ground? Are we using them, investing them, risking them, sharing them, that they might create an even greater abundance of that which is so precious? One way we may conceive of our relationships with that which we value is the idea of attachment and detachment. Are our attachments healthy? Do we cling too tightly to that which we value because we're afraid to lose it? Author Kathleen Norris, in her book, Amazing Grace, A Vocabulary of Faith, considers our relationship with what we value, citing the monastic notion of detachment. Not detachment like becoming aloof detachment, but detachment like letting go of things that we cling so tightly to. A monastic interpretation of detachment, she writes, means not allowing either worldly values or self-centeredness to distract us from what is most essential to our relationship with God and with each other. Norris goes on to quote 6th century monk Dorotheus of Gaza, who described detachment as being free from wanting things to happen, remaining trusting of God that what is happening will be the thing you want to happen, and you will be at peace with it all. The late contemplative Thomas Merton, who also writes about detachment, reminds us of the importance healthy detachment from not only possessions and worldly achievements, but even spiritual attachments. In New Seeds of Contemplation, he writes, attachment to spiritual things is therefore just as much an attachment as inordinate love of anything else. He is aware that life constantly changes and that we attach to things in order to deal with that change, including spiritual things like prayer, he says. We can cling unhealthily to prayer. That was a new idea to me. So how can we use our gifts and our talents in our lives and in the community so that the master would be happy upon returning. Yes, we do not want to cling too tightly to that which we value, and yet we don't want to be so detached that much of what we do might seem disinterested or apathetic. Is there a happy medium? Can we cherish what we value, but not hold on to it too tightly, or simply put it in the ground? To which Jesus answers, yes. It may be hard to conceptualize, as I mentioned earlier, but one way to imagine it is through metaphor. For those of you who have played golf or tennis, can I see any hands? I can tell who's a lefty now, too. You have learned that an ideal swing or stroke is not swinging it as hard as you can. Swinging too hard leads to poor contact with the ball and lack of control. Conversely, being so careful with your swing or stroke without any oomph will give you very little power or distance. But the world-class golfers and tennis players swing hard, but not their hardest. They develop an ability to harness their control, and it becomes natural to them. To control the ball, the athlete can't tense up, but must let go. Several years ago, members of Forest Hill Church in Cleveland Heights, Ohio, were puzzled when one day they came to worship and were greeted at the door, handed by an usher an envelope. People opened the envelopes. Children shrieked with excitement. Adults traded astonished grins. The pastor, John Lentz, explained why every worshiper had been handed an envelope with a $50 bill. It was the start of Forest Hill's Big Give. Inspired by today's parable of the talents, church leaders entrusted members with the money as they saw fit. In his sermon that day, Pastor Lentz challenged the worshipers to look at their lives and the world not through a lens of scarcity, but through a lens of abundance. Multiply the gift, they were told, in whatever way you can. The only stipulation was that at least $50 should be returned to the church and go to mission work. Pastor Lentz told the congregation, use your gifts, lighten your grip and open your hands, and let go and receive. Some Forest Hills members multiplied their money by astonishing amounts. Others used it to go ahead and help neighbors in need. The church had committed $15,000 to this experiment with the $50 bills, and more than $27,000 came back for ministries of justice and outreach at home and around the world. This year, our stewardship committee decided to do the same thing. If you'd like to open the envelopes you have in front of you, you'll find a $100 bill. Not really. The stewardship committee... Sorry. I didn't consider that unintended consequence. But I do think, had we chosen to do that, Jesus would have been okay with it. In all seriousness, we are pretty much doing the same thing anyway. We are pledging gifts to be used for the work of God's kingdom in the world. As a church, we can be careful, protective, and risk-averse, or we can take our gifts of the Master, get out there, take some risk, and continue going to work. After all, God's goodness and all of the gifts of our lives are just too valuable to bury in the ground. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
What you sow, what you plant in them. Thank you.
were reminded by the beautiful anthem of the choir, and as we are reminded from 2 Corinthians, the one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. The one who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Let us sow the gifts of our hearts that were given to us by God.
Just a little background about the group you're about to hear. We work on Sundays at the church, and the gentlemen graciously give up having first gifts at the treats that are in the back. So we do appreciate them for that. But we have a group of three young gentlemen who Eli on bass clarinet has been playing only since September. And Isaac, this is his fifth year of band. He's over at Eldorado in their marching band also. And Gavin's kind of in between, almost exactly these 3 years. So we appreciate the fact that you're letting us play for you today.
And just a reminder, in case there's any confusion, this is the regular offering, not where we're going to come forward.
Thank you.
Dios celestial, te damos gracias por este día, por todos los dones, regalos, recursos que nos des en esta vida. Puras bendiciones. Y te pedimos que nos inspires a usarlos para tu gloria, para invertirlos con amor en este mundo, en esta congregación. Amén. Before we bow our heads one more time in prayer, does anyone have a joy or a concern they would like to lift up to the community? Ken? A prayer of joy for bringing Joel into our community. Thank you. Are there others? Yes, David.
Today is Autumn's birthday. The little girl we've been praying for a whole year, she made it. We had a birthday party yesterday, so she's doing good, and we're all thankful for that. And also today is also my first granddaughter's birthday. She's turning 8 today. Eliana. Thank you.
Happy birthday to Autumn, who just turned 1, who we've been praying for a long time, and we're excited that she is at her first birthday. And prayers also for David's first granddaughter, Eliana, who is now 8 years old. Tina.
Prayers for Alexis Martinez, who is Joseph's girlfriend. Her grandmother passed away last night. Well, it's her great-great-grandmother. She's 102. And prayers for my Uncle Carlos and my Aunt Lena. And prayers of joy that Julian turned 21 this month.
prayers for Alexis Martinez, who is the girlfriend of Jason, who lost her great-great-grandmother. Prayers, continued prayers, as we mentioned, for Carlos and also for Lena. And then prayers for Julian, who just turned 21 years old. And how hard is that? Sharon.
I'd like continued prayers for my Uncle George Hill, my friend Paula Rielli, she suffers from vertigo. And also, I just found out my neighbor, Margie Sinch, is in this hospital. Prayers for them.
That's your neighbor, you said?
Neighbor, yeah.
Okay. Continued prayers for George B. Hill, who's not doing well. Prayers also for a friend, Paula, who has vertigo, who I believe we prayed for before. Continued prayers. And then also prayers for neighbor Margie, who has recently been hospitalized. Eli.
Yes. Progress report on my wife, Carol. She's doing a little better, getting around better with her walker. But she also wanted to express, and I do too, with all the thanks for all the prayers and thoughts and food and all the cards that all of you have sent. We really appreciate it, and it's really been helpful. Thank you again. I have some of those plates. You can refill the plates.
Eli would like to thank you all on behalf of his wife, Carol, who's been recovering from her broken head. Thank you for your prayers, your concerns, your visits. And thank you for the food. And he said that the food is now gone, and the plates are empty if you want to refill them. Are there any others? Yes, Sally. You will recall that we prayed for Sally's sister Rika, and now surgery has been scheduled for her sinuses and for her brain at the Jewish hospital in Arizona?
No, Denver.
In Denver, okay. We will continue to keep Rika in our prayers. Would you please let her know? So what I mentioned.
Joyce Linovet asked for prayers for her sister. Joyce has gone to Virginia. Her sister had a serious stroke, so she asked for prayers for them.
Thank you. Prayers for Joyce Levitt, who you will notice is not in the choir today. She went to Virginia to be with her sister, who just suffered a stroke. So prayers specifically for her sister.
Prayers for my sister, Minnie, who is 94 years old and had a flu shot and had gotten an reaction from her stomach.
Prayers for Minnie Olivas, Dolores, and Dorothy's sister of 94, who's doing pretty well, and apparently also had an adverse reaction to the flu shot. So prayers for her.
A month or so ago, our eldest child was diagnosed with cancer, was prepared to do a significant amount of radiation beginning this week, and now it's had two slides come back with no evidence of cancer. We don't know whether to pray for a miracle and thank God, or whether to hope that good diagnostics and definitions get made in this next week or so. But please keep the wisdom of both God and physicians in your prayers.
Carmen lifts up a prayer for her son Jeff, who was diagnosed with cancer and was expecting to take some rigorous treatments, but now the cancer did not show up, which is both wonderful but a little confusing. So prayers for his physicians, for Jeff, for Carmen, and all of them. Yes, Sunday.
Prayers for Alicia and I. Adam, the Hugh was not doing well. She has cancer in her neck, and she's
okay. Prayers for one of the people that Sandra takes care of. Her name is Ellen McHugh. They have found cancer in her lymph nodes. She's going to have a procedure this week and a postponement. So prayers for her, her caregiver, and her support system and family.
I spoke with Tony Romero this week on the telephone, and I think he needs some prayers.
Don lifts up in prayer Tony Romero. He spoke with him on the telephone this week and senses that he is in need of prayer. Thank you. Bob.
Prayers for all the great music this morning.
Prayers for all the great music this morning and for all of the great directors of music who are doing things. Any others? Yeah, oh, yes, Joy.
Prayers for safe travels for the community who are traveling to see families.
Prayers for safe travels for those who will be traveling over Thanksgiving, which I know is many of you. Thank you. Kendra, did you have a hand up?
Yes. I pray for Anna's mommy, and also for Joy, on Tuesday.
Prayers for Ani's mom, who will be undergoing surgery. Prayers that everything goes well. And prayers also, happy birthday prayer for Melody, who's turning two. The wonderful twos on Tuesday. Orlando.
Yeah, prayers of Thanksgiving that my granddaughters will be in church today. We're happy to have them.
Orlando lifts up prayers of joy to have he and Sandra's granddaughters here in church. Smiles and happy people to see them. And prayers for their education and as they're growing up. It's incredible how fast that happens. So prayers for the development. Bunch up and then.
Prayers for the homeless this Thanksgiving season and Christmas.
Prayers for the homeless during the season that it's starting to get colder over the holidays. And I would also add prayers for those whom the holidays can be very difficult. Maybe more loneliness, or missing family members, something of the sort. Jared?
For River Quinones, we have surgery on the right.
Oh. Thank you. Jerry, also prays for Reverend Quinones, who's going to have surgery on his other eye as well. Yes.
I don't know if it's a joy or a concern, but Esther's having a birthday this week.
That's a joy,
Jesse. But I'm glad that she's catching up to me.
Happy birthday to Esther. We celebrate another year of your life and your endeavor to catch up to Tessa. Let us bow our heads in a word of prayer. We give you thanks, O Lord, for another day. We give you thanks, O Lord, for a beautiful day. We are reminded by the power of your creation on this morn, reminded of your amazing blessings, the beautiful mountains, the sunshine. Lord, we ask that you help us to be mindful this morning, mindful of all of the ways in which we have been blessed, far too many to count, but help us concurrently, O Lord, be mindful where there might be the lack of blessings in our lives or in the lives of people around us or in the world or in our community. Lord, may those realities of both joy, appreciation, sense of your grace, but may the reality of darkness and difficulty that also pervades our world, sometimes our lives, may they both inspire us. May we live out of gratitude, but may we also live out of an understanding of need. And Lord, may we be guided by the only thing that can help us traverse those two realities, which is your incredible love. Help us to be mindful of that love. Help us to be reminded that it is in abundance and it is not a scarce resource. Lord, we thank you for the community in which we can worship, honor you with beautiful music, lift up prayers, have the support of one another, and ultimately of you. We ask, O Lord, that you would hear the prayers spoken, but you would also hear the prayers that are in our hearts. And now, Lord, we join our voices into one as we pray the prayer your Son taught us. Padre nuestro, que estás en los cielos, santificado sea tu nombre. Venga tu reino, hágase tu voluntad, como en el cielo, así también en la tierra. El pan nuestro de cada día, danos hoy, y perdónanos nuestras deudas, como también nosotros perdonamos a nuestros deudores. Y no nos dejes caer en tentación, mas líbranos del mal, porque tuyo es el reino, y el poder, y la gloria, por todos los siglos. Brothers and sisters, at this time, you will be invited, should you choose to bring forward your pledge for the coming year. In previous years, we've had music played as we come forward. This year, we're going to sing a hymn together. So you may want to also turn to number 697, Take My Life, and come forward and sing as you feel led. And if you can come forward, raise your hand afterwards and we'll find you.
Thank you.
talents you've given us, and help us in the year 2018 to give all of who we are to serve you and to love our neighbor as ourselves. And all God's people say,
Amen.
Thank you.
That was her. You know, Camila's my godmother. That's where she gets her voice from.
Thank you.